This is the reverberation room. So if we actually conducted the rest of this video in that room, we're not going to really be able to understand it too well because of all the reverberation. So we'll chat out here. The room is designed to have all acoustically hard materials, floor, walls, and ceiling. So at least 95% of all the acoustic energy reflected off of all of those surfaces. So rather than absorbing virtually any of it, everything's gonna keep bouncing around until eventually it will die out. Sound is gonna persist in there if there are no absorptive surfaces for more than 4 seconds. So a reverberation time of about 4 seconds.
Am I understanding correctly that the difference between that and a regular room would be that in a regular room, you've got the inverse square law and absorption that would attenuate the sound levels, whereas in here, the sound will basically only be attenuated by the inverse square law?
Oh, yeah. Really, air attenuation is the primary factor. So if you didn't have attenuation from air, sound could persist indefinitely, but you're going to get some of it that is absorbed by the air. So after a number of reflections in several seconds, that energy does get completely neutralized. In classrooms, you want to have a specific reverberation time, and that's usually 0.7 seconds or less. Here, a reverberation time about 4 seconds, several times more than what you'd have. That number is based on good speech intelligibility. So you'd never want to hold a class in that facility.
Now in here, I think we actually could probably have a conversation that Absolutely. Would come across in video. All right, but before we do, tell us about what this helps us understand about this room.
Yeah, so this is a Brühl & Kjaer Type 2250 sound level analyzer, and it's set to show us what the level is in a space, and it's been calibrated. So we can see from this, the background noise level is about 32 decibels. Talking, we get about 65 decibels, and this is an A-weighted LEQ, so an overall level that's showing us a typical talking environment as well as the background noise. Double doors, as well as a pretty neat design for closing this door. So it opens into the wall, maximizing the space that we have inside. Taking that same measurement in here. The anechoic chamber, we can see we get about 17 decibels of background noise. That's A-weighted. Talking at about the same level, getting about 58.5 as my A-weighted overall level, my LAEQ.
So unnatural to be in here. First off, I've got some tinnitus that comes out. It's that noise level that I'm used to, I guess masking that perceptually, has disappeared. And you get right a little bit. But not only that, your voice sounds completely different. And I don't know if this comes across on the video. We've got mics and they probably sound very dry. In the past, I've done a video with a binaural head and that kind of brought it across. But I'll tell you, it's something that I have never felt the exact experience other than actually being inside here. I feel like I have the tendency to want to speak louder mm-hmm. as well. You feel that too?
Yeah, you get the mix of reactions. You get some people who feel like they need to amplify the voice to compensate for this. You also get other people who come in and the body language kind of shifts, feeling like, oh, I'm making all the noise in this space and I need to kind of crouch and whisper to feel a little bit more comfortable. So kind of see a whole range of different experiences that people have.
I think it would be really cool to see the directionality of any instrument, you know, like you said, the human, move a mic and experiment with that, but also similar to the acoustic guitar miking video that we just made earlier, it seems like a really cool room to understand how sounds radiate from any source, right?
Yeah, and that's what one of the main types of projects we do with a student in here is directionality measurements. Because you don't have any of those reflections, you can determine exactly where the sound is coming from. Two ways you can do it, one, a rotating boom mic, which we have in the other facility, or by having an array of mics set at different positions, generate a sound. We've done tests with acoustic guitars where students designed an automated picking mechanism, even though
People can be very good at replicating the same level. We wanted even, more precision, maybe less musicality, but more precision on exactly the same force struck each time. And then they generated those directivity plots. Particularly, it was for determining how was the sound going to change when you change one of the materials on the guitar. Was it going to improve the sound? Was it going to make it so that it spread out more? We wanted to answer those questions.
Well, that's a project that you and I worked on a couple of years ago, trying to find out what is the effect of removing the head of a kick drum versus having a head on the kick drum with no porthole, and then what happens when you put a porthole in the front? How can we measure that? And we used this facility. We made a robotic kick drum pedal, and we used an acoustic camera to measure the sound intensity level of what happens in front of the kick drum head in this room, so that we're sure we're just getting exactly what's coming off the kick drum, and there's no influence of the room whatsoever. And we could find, intensity plots from our results, which ended up becoming an AES paper that we can make some images available for if it's of interest to the viewership.
Awesome.
But that's part of the investigative properties of, of a scientific study in sound, is you have to remove variables.
Yep.
Right? And so this is one of the most unique places to do research, because you've removed one of the most difficult variables to control for and to understand, because even moving a small inch this way or that way can result in a massive change in acoustics. But when you've eliminated that part, you can really ask some more specific questions and not be influenced by the things around you.
Yeah, I'm very jealous, because I have a scientist at heart, but my bedroom is probably not the most empirical environment to create actual studies. I mean, look at this thing. This is not just like your Amazon.com SPL meter. This is very, very nice. You said it was calibrated. It provides reliable data. Everything about this place is very controlled. Like you said, the intensity, we can get close enough as humans, but if you want it to be really solid data, then you have to control for everything you possibly can, right? That's awesome.
Well, before you leave today, we'll make sure that we get an acoustic guitar in your hands again so you can see what this room sounds like. And we'll do that again in the reverberation room to see the differences between all three environments.
One last thing I wanted to ask. In the video we just made, we discussed the idea of the critical distance, right? I would imagine that in the reverberation room, the critical distance is extremely short. Critical distance meaning the point in the room where the direct sound and indirect sound are at an equal level. Is there even a critical distance possible in this room? I wouldn't imagine, right?
Not really, yeah. Because in this case, just like you had mentioned outside, this is a free field environment. So even though we're clearly indoors, almost all the sound that's leaving never comes back. So it replicates that free field environment very well, meaning that, you couldn't even calculate a critical distance because of that.
And one other thing I'll mention, I guess, is that this is not what I would describe as a perfect room for mixing, right? We often feel that we don't have enough acoustic treatment, but there's a level where there's way too much acoustic treatment. And we've certainly reached that level from a music production standpoint, maybe not from a scientific research standpoint, but definitely from a listening standpoint. So how do you think we should think about walking that line?
The line between going too far with acoustic treatment?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, between the perfect room for music production, whether it's recording or mixing or even home theater, enjoyment of music and sound, it has to be something between this and the reverb room.
Yeah. Well, we want to make sure that when we're doing our mixes, that the sounds that we're reacting to are similar to what someone might experience in their own listening environments. So if you make it entirely dry like this, what you're reacting to and what you're recreating for others is going to only be experienced in a space like this. Right. So the idea of a controlled mix facility is one where you're controlling the decay times of relative frequencies across the audible spectrum within the construct of music, right? And the frequencies that musical instruments generate and the way they're performed. And you're doing it in loudspeakers, and the room can give back a little bit and should, because we don't listen to things in a vacuum. We listen to them in au naturel, in the wild. Acoustically buck naked, whatever is in the room is going to be part of the story. And you can't mix in a space that's just like everybody's living room, because we don't all live in the same living room, right? Right, Chris?
Yeah.
So we have to, but we can come into a room like this and figure out what are the things and the tools that we utilize that might be influencing our choices in a controlled mix environment, right? That isn't completely dry. It's a way to say, we have these really nice little speakers, you know, these Genelecs, they sound wonderful, but how much of what we're hearing is the Genelec versus what we know to be the original signal, right? And so that gives us a starting point for understanding then what happens when we take that into a not free field environment where we have, you know, boundaries that are going to be reflecting surface information back to us at time delays. So the ideal is to create an even decay time across all frequencies as best you can, with the understanding that we do have some preferences for certain frequencies, and that's the tuning of the room. And you know, tuning is strobe tuners and things for instruments, like that's relative to within a degree of error. There's still a lot of tolerance there, and we still understand that this guitar is in tune, right? And similarly in rooms, you want to be able to tune your room, but you might decide you want a little bit extra low end because you mix, music that benefits from a little bit of extra, you know, artificial help in resonance in the low end. So rooms can be tuned just the way guitars can. And that's not to say you can't modify your own tunings, right? Or invent your own tunings. But in music mix rooms, we're really trying to make the music consistent so that when we make our choices, they're relatable to an average listening experience on the back end, on the consumer side, right? And not just making it in this super hyper-controlled imaginarium where you really, like you said, you can't experience it until you walk into it. And then there's all these other biological factors that kick in that we don't have when we have normal listening experiences. So yeah, the goal is, you know, you would never want these in your room, but if you had a resonance of say 20 hertz at the back of your room, some of these wedges might be helpful in taming those in those specific areas, right, Chris?
Yeah, and I think that touches on another kind of beautiful aspect of sound and acoustics, is that there's subjectivity, and it's quantifiable that there's subjectivity. If I measure 65 decibels A-weighted of background noise, that's an unimpeachable number. It's an accurate number, factory calibrated device. But is that loud? That might be a different answer from one person to the next. And that's why there's going to be preference on different types of room setups. And maybe the best mixing room for one person might not be the best mixing room for another person. So that subjectivity is a pretty fun aspect of studying, because, you know, like I said, outside, without the human aspect, sound sound isn't all that worth studying.
One more thing I'll add to this is that in an acoustic design of a mix room, you really want the room to be working in tandem with your loudspeakers. So your loudspeakers perform at certain amplitudes, at certain frequencies. So the idea is to treat your room in such a way that complements the speakers you've chosen for your room. I know some folks who've like tried certain speakers in their room that have already been built for other speakers and been like, these sound no good, even though they're very high quality speakers, but they're not going to perform ideally because their curvature profiles are different than the way other high quality, you know, speakers are tuned. And so, you know, the subjectivity is also part of the design, right? The design factor of these loudspeakers. So Genelecs sound wonderful. We could design an entire room based on those Genelecs and then put NS10s in there, and it won't sound as good or as even. And that's because we didn't design a room around the NS10s and their curvatures and their characteristics. So there's no one way to, you can't just kill them all and, you know, have it sound good. The idea is to reinforce the things that need reinforcing or may benefit, and that's a subjective choice to some extent. And then also dampen the things that are maybe a little bit out of control because of the characteristics of the room that you're in, which is just the acoustics of the space, right? The nodes of the space.
Guys, your passion is it comes across, and I'm just so thankful for you. Thank you, Chris.
Yeah, thank you.
I could probably sit here and ask you questions all day, but I got to get that guitar in here and do some cool experiments. So the moment you've been waiting for, what were you going to say?
Let's pop some balloons, too.
Yeah, true. Let's do it.